Today's video is going to be 60% tutorial, 30% rant, and 40% very important tips. That gives us 130%. That's okay. I like to give you a little more each video. Roll intro. Hi everyone, welcome to Pal to Tech. Like many camera companies, Fujifilm provides a downloadable app that promises features such as remote control of the camera, image transfer to your phone, geotagging, and so forth. For the purpose of this video, I will be reviewing app version 4.6.1.6. While I test it in both Apple phones, Android devices, and iPads, I will be using the iPhone 12 for the purpose of this demo for this video. Now, in order to be sure that you're getting all of the functionality that's available in the app, both Bluetooth and Wi-Fi need to be enabled, and location services should be allowed for the app if you want to have the GPS feature working. There's also a special online Fujifilm instruction manual for the app. I'll have a link to that down below as well in the description of this video. Now, the app supports both Bluetooth and Wi-Fi connections to your camera. However, not all Fujifilm cameras support Bluetooth. In particular, the X-T2 camera is Wi-Fi only, while the X-T3 and the X-T4 support both. However, for almost all of the features on the app, I found that you will constantly be asked to connect using the Wi-Fi connection to your camera. We'll get more into that in a little bit. Make sure that you have an SD card in your camera, obviously, right? Also, make sure that you do not have an HDMI cable plugged into the camera. You might see one plugged into mine, but that's because I'm recording the screen for this video. I'm not sure what's going on here, but having the HDMI port active and connected to an external monitor while at the same time trying to connect the camera to the app can cause a lot of connection issues. So once you've downloaded the app, obviously the first thing you're gonna wanna do is open it up. And it'll ask you to pick a camera. Pretty easy, I'm gonna pick the X System interchangeable lens, and I'll do the X-T4 for this demo, click add. Then you get to this screen right here. This is the point where you wanna put down the app, you wanna pick up the camera and get your settings ready. Go into the menu, and you're gonna go into the wrench, into connection setting, then go into Bluetooth settings, and make sure that Bluetooth is turned on, very important. Then go to pairing registration, and it'll say searching. At this point, back to the device, tap proceed, and now it will search. Ah, it found it. You see that? Tap that just like that, and it'll say connecting. You do have to wait a while sometimes. And there we go. Go ahead and tap start. And this is the main screen of the app window that you'll see. Now, when you go back to your camera, it'll say, do you want to set date time from smartphone? Sure, I'll go ahead and set the date time. Fine. And you're back at this menu right here. Going back to the app now, let's have a look at the interface. At the top, you can choose the camera, and you can add additional cameras, so you can have multiple cameras being controlled by the same app. You also have these two icons right here that are very difficult to see. One of them shows you an active Bluetooth connection. The other shows you your active Wi-Fi connection. Now, most of the things that you need to do require a Wi-Fi connection. So here's the thing, and this is what trips people up. When you start doing a task on this app, like you want to go into live shoot mode, or you want to control the camera, or you want to transfer images, or whatever, you need to wait until the little window pops up that says connect to the Fujifilm Wi-Fi. And if you don't see that come up, you may need to go into your Wi-Fi settings and look for that Wi-Fi connection to connect with. Either way, you need to be sure you're connecting to your camera's Wi-Fi. All right, so the very first thing we're going to do is live view shooting. I'm going to go ahead and tap on that, and you just need to wait. Here's the important part. You must connect to the Wi-Fi network, which is the Fujifilm one. So I'm clicking join. Now you wait again. Lot of waiting with this app, but just wait it out. There you go. We are now connected, okay? So what this camera is seeing right now will appear on your device. Now, when you're in live view mode, you are connected via Wi-Fi. This is important to remember. If you tap out of it, if you click that X right here, you will exit Wi-Fi mode and you will have to join back Wi-Fi again to go back into the remote control. That's what trips a lot of people up because they keep leaving Wi-Fi and then going back in. it's not connecting. As I'm trying to demo this to you, the app is not functioning properly. See, it just, I keep tapping live view shooting, it keeps saying connecting, and then it returns to the screen and nothing happens. Now, it's not connecting. I cannot tell you how many different phones and tablets and devices I tested for this video, and it worked correctly and without flaw 5% of the time. So here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna show you what works to try and get around that problem if you run into the same thing. So if you see this message on your phone, go ahead and tap the arrow to get out of this screen right here, get back to here. Then what I do is I go to my camera, and I have to show you like this. I can't show you on the HDMI because I had to disconnect HDMI. So what I did was I went back, disconnected. You press the playback button just like this, okay? Then what you do is you press the menu OK button. Boom. That gets you into this menu. Scroll down until you get to wireless communication. You see that right there? Wireless communication. Then go ahead and there you go, just like that. Okay, then look at the phone. Look what happened. The menu popped up, you see that? I'm gonna go ahead and click join. Let's see if it gets us in there. Okay, yes, it looks like we're in there because now this icon shows Wi-Fi. So now let's go back to live view shooting and see if it works. Tapping live view shooting. Okay, not sure why it's asking to connect to Wi-Fi again since we already did, but here it is. You know, this video could change directions and turn into a rant. Unbelievable. Come on. There we go. Ah, now on the back of the camera, you will see this message right here. Okay, and I'm gonna say yes. So now we have our app running. Finally, there's a few things that you can do. First of all, you've got some information at the top that shows you the film sim and the number of shots and so forth. Then on the image itself, you can move the focus point around by tapping on the screen. You see that? To move the focus point. And the minute you do that, it will autofocus to the area that you're tapping. Below the screen, you have information. These are not tappable. You have to actually go below that to here. So for example, shutter speed right here. There it is. And you can change your shutter speed all the way up to 1/8000th of a second and all the way down to as low as 15 minutes. Aperture can be adjusted, ISO can be adjusted as well, and it's great because you can change the film simulation, which is really nice. White balance is a little, and you see these things that keep popping up. This is why I hate using smartphones for these things. All right, no, just, so annoying. You can change the white balance, but it's kind of limited. For example, color temperature doesn't allow you to actually modify the Kelvin or the color temperature at all. Same with, for example, custom. It doesn't allow you to set a custom white balance. So most of the time you'll want to keep it in auto. And obviously to take a photo, very simple. Just press this button right here. And that's it. I just took a photo of my subject, Gary Iguana. The fastest and easiest way to access the photos once you've shot them, right, is to tap this area right up here, boom. And what happens is it goes into this mode right here where you can then see the photos that are on your SD card on the camera. And from there, you can transfer them to your phone. Pretty basic stuff, okay? And if you wanna go back to live shooting mode, just tap that area at the top right here. And it crashed again. This is the worst. So now you're back here. Okay, and now you're back to live shooting mode. Now, the reason I told you to tap this area up here is because that's the fastest way to switch from live shooting mode over to reviewing the images you shot and transferring them to your phone. So the other way is tap this X right here and see how it says exit live shooting mode, okay? What happens is now you've exited the live shooting mode, you're back here. Now, obviously, you can tap on import images selected, right? But see, now you have to go through the whole connection process again. That's the problem. It takes a lot longer and you have to reconnect to Wi-Fi in order to do that. You also have the remote release. So for example, you tap remote release and you can simply take a photo using the remote release, right? Like this. There, I just took a shot. The other thing you could do is you could put the camera in burst mode. So for example, I'm going to turn this dial to CL. You can hold this down and take a burst round of shots. It acts like the bulb function for the shutter release. Lastly, another way of getting images imported into the phone from the camera is to go into playback mode by pressing that button right there. And now in playback mode, once you're in playback mode, you tap this area on the device, join the network yet again. And then what happens is you see this kind of blank screen. Now you have to put down the device, pick up the camera, and then you can choose okay to transmit or back to cancel. I'm gonna go ahead and transmit this image. Boom, just like that. And you see it's now sending the image to the phone. There's a couple of things you need to know about sending images to your phone. The first is that you cannot send raw files to your phone, only JPEGs. The second is that you can control the resolution of the images that are sent to your phone. You go into connection setting, down below where it says general settings, resize image for smartphone. If that's set to off, then it will transfer the full size JPEG and you'll have an image transferred that's 6240 by 4160. If you have it turned on just like that, then you will have an image only transferred that's 1776 by 1184. And the file size will be different. If it's transferring the regular size image, you're looking at about almost 12 megabytes. The version sized for the phone, if you enable that option, will only be about 650 kilobytes. That's a huge size difference. And you would only want to do that if you're, say, posting to Instagram or something like that. You can turn geotagging on and location info on. And if you do that, you do need to make sure, look for cam remote, and make sure that location is set to always, right? Or at the very minimum, while using the app. I would like to show you more and show you demos of how the GPS was put on there, but in all the testing I did for this app, whether it was on an iPhone 12, iPhone 11, iPad, or a Samsung Galaxy S7, not one time did GPS work properly or reliably. Not once. So I'm not even gonna show this because I'm never gonna use it, and I recommend you never use it either. There are third-party apps that will allow and offer a much better way to put GPS location data onto your images. I will have links to those in the description of this video. Now we come to the part of the video where I offer up some of my troubleshooting tips and some usability problems that I hope will both actually help you as well as inform Fuji what I think needs to be improved in this app. Number one are the accessibility problems. Using a dark gray color on a black background is literally impossible to see these icons outside in sunlight, and it's difficult to see them indoors as well. There needs to be either a light mode or a high contrast mode that'll work in all shooting environments. Another area that kept confusing me was that you have icons right below the image right here. You see that? For example, ISO 400, but you can't just tap those. You would think you could just tap that area and change the setting. You have to go down to the ISO value below that. Better to just have one row of icons to tap, right? And that way you can see immediately what your value is, and then if you don't like that and want to change it, boom, you tap it and you're good to go. Number two is manual focusing. If you try and put your focus mode into manual and manually focus the lens, it will not work. You must use the tiny little square in the touchscreen to touch and show where you want your focus to be. So basically you cannot manual focus at all. And that's the problem, is having all of the camera controls completely disabled while in live view shooting makes it impossible to just quickly adjust something if you need to, and it prevents the ability to focus manually. Number three, GPS is extremely problematic. I could not for the life of me get this thing to accurately and consistently work. And the restrictions of location data being older than 2 hours not being transmitted to the camera, I see that as being limited. Number four is setting custom white balance or trying to, you know, adjust your color temperature. It's not possible to do that. And adding an ability to adjust the Kelvin setting would be a great feature for this app. Number five, switching from various functions and tasks while using the app constantly disconnects you and reconnects you to Wi-Fi. The whole Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, switching around and dual settings is the single biggest problem with the app. So to save time, don't exit out of that live view mode. Just tap that area I showed you to go into the photo selection mode. That is the best tip I can give you. Number six, the app only works in vertical mode. It will not work in horizontal mode, right? However, smartphones have been able to go from, you know, vertical to horizontal since about 2008.
There's one that's this landscape, I can just turn my device and take a look at it. Pretty cool, huh?
So it would be great to see that ability in this app. It would also help that touch focus issue that I mentioned earlier, as it would take advantage of larger screen real estate to achieve better focus accuracy. Number 7, there needs to be a warning, either in the online manual or better yet, right in the app itself, that tells you to make sure that auto power on your camera is set to off so that your camera doesn't, you know, auto power off and just disconnect. Number 8, and this is a big one. The video mode on the app does not record the video settings that you make on the camera. For example, if you set your video mode to 4K, 24 frames a second, and you use the app to start recording, you're only going to get 1080p at 30 frames a second. And I couldn't find anywhere in the app instructions or in some kind of manual that warns of this. That's a big deal. If you're thinking that you're recording in one frame rate and in one resolution, and actually, well, we're not really doing that. We're gonna give you this one. That's kind of a big deal. So there is no way to record 4K video with the app, and there's no way to record 24 frames a second. Number 9, it would be really helpful to have a rule of thirds frame overlay, which would be a nice feature that you could have on the app. That was 9 suggestions. If you know of any, I would like that to be the 10th suggestion, because I do think that Fuji watches these videos, and any suggestions you have, maybe ones that I miss, either way, mention them in the comments below. This would be suggestion number 10 that you come up with. I just got back from Home Depot, where I had to buy not one, but 2 cans of wall spackle to fix the holes in my studio wall where I was beating my head against in trying to get this app to work. I'm not joking, it was so frustrating. Fujifilm makes the best mirrorless cameras on earth, but you folks need to improve this app considerably. Go back to the drawing board. Get feedback from your users. Start with this video. And let's see an awesome version 5 with some of these issues fixed and some of these usability, let's call them problems, resolved. I'm gonna give the Fujifilm Cam Remote app a C-. This was one of the most difficult videos I've ever done for this channel. I didn't even go over the ability to send, you know, an image to a printer or to update the firmware of your camera using the app. There is no way in hell I would update the firmware on my Fujifilm camera using this app and its connection reliability. Well, thank you so much for watching. This has been a tough video to put together. Let me tell you, and if I came off a little bit on the rant side, I apologize. This was frustrating for me, and I'm just being honest with you, you know, I owe you that. So anyhow, I'm gonna get out of here, and I will see you in another video again real soon. Take care.